You're watching the Two Guys Talking Podcast Network.
We're outside the Peabody Opera House where they've just hosted the Radio City Christmas Spectacular. And they're soon featuring the Moscow Ballet's version of the Nutcracker. Why all these holiday themed shows? Because it's Christmas time here on Streetscape. So grab a cup of hot cocoa and stay tuned. The Kiel Opera House originally opened in 1934 and once hosted the only live television broadcast ever performed by the Rat Pack. Recently, the Kiel underwent a $79 million renovation and reopened as the Peabody Opera House in October of 2011. As you can see, the old girl hasn't lost her looks. Stay with us for the next half hour as we take you to a new medical facility bringing healthcare to St. Charles, get an update from Scott Tate at the Greater St. Charles County Chamber of Commerce, look in on our favorite olive oil specialist Robert over at Olívas, learn more about UMB Bank's customer relationships, see why Sanctuaria is an urban sanctuary, and check in with my buddy Todd Gentry to get more financial tips. First up, I'm going to take you to an innovative bakery in Newtown that has a fresh take on creating their goodies. Hi, Nicole. Hi, Angel.
Hi, April. Hi, Angel.
All right, I just have to say that it smells yummalicious in here, and everything looks so pretty.
Thank you. Yeah.
So tell us what makes your bakery so different from every other.
Well, we are a paleo bakery, which means that we do not use any gluten, grain, soy, or dairy in our products.
Why is that important?
Well, many people have found that if they eliminate certain foods from their diet, certain foods that are inflammatory or they have an allergic reaction to, that their overall health and wellness is greatly improved. Those ingredients, gluten, grain, soy, and dairy, are the main causes of a lot of inflammatory reactions in people. So our products are made without any of those things, and they taste really yummy. So when people figure out, or they're told by their doctor they have to eat this way, they don't have to give up treats.
And then how did it evolve into this? What made you say, hey, let's just make it bigger and open a bakery?
I have migraines, and I've dealt with that for a long time. Angel deals with asthma, and so we were told that if we eliminated these inflammatory products from our diet, that they would greatly improve. And we did. We noticed a huge improvement. We felt much better. But we missed treats. We missed cookies. We missed cakes. We missed muffins, because you can't eat the regular stuff on this kind of diet. So I started making my own.
Now, when you started baking on your own, I hear that you started sharing it, and it was a great hit.
Right, yeah, we did. We started sharing it with family members and friends at first, and then somebody suggested we take it to the local farmer's market and see if anybody, you know, was interested in it, and we did. We sold out of everything we brought the first week, and we brought more the next week and sold out of that, and had a lot of repeat customers. They, you know, wanted to know when we were going to open a bakery and have the stuff available all the time for them, because they were in the same boat that we were, where they could not find these products in their regular, you know, local grocery stores.
Well, most people think that when you start taking out the sugar and the regular flour, that it's going to taste weird. But you've had some really great reactions from your clients.
Yes, yes. Actually, we had a bride and groom who asked us to do their wedding because they had already ordered their regular wedding cake, the really expensive wedding cake. They couldn't get their deposit back on it, and they found out that they couldn't eat gluten. And so they asked if we would make them a little cake that they could, you know, use to feed to each other for the pictures and whatnot. And we did, and they told us afterwards they loved it, and they had to fight off their other guests because they didn't want to eat the regular wedding cake. They wanted to eat, you know, one of our cakes. We've also had a lot of parents who have had to eliminate things from their children's diets, especially dairy and soy. And once you do that, you can't eat regular chocolate. So their kids have never had a chocolate chip cookie. And so we've had them come up and, you know, try our cookies, make sure that there wasn't anything in there that, you know, their child would, you know, get sick from or have an allergic reaction to, and then, you know, have them try the cookie, and they were, you know, coming back for more because they're like, he's never had a chocolate chip cookie and he loves these things.
And your chocolate tastes like real chocolate.
Yes, our chocolate chips are soy and dairy-free chocolate chips, but they are chocolate. They are cocoa, so they taste like chocolate.
And everything's made right here in-house.
Yes, everything is handmade here at the bakery.
And you do deliveries, right?
Yes, we have gift baskets available for the holidays, which are available for delivery or pickup. We also do special order cakes.
Now, where else can people get your goodies?
Some of our products are available at the local Harvest Grocery. There's one in Kirkwood, and there's also one on Morgan Ford. And they are available at O'Fallon Nutrition and at Picasso's Coffee House.
Thank you guys for coming to Newtown.
You're welcome. We're really excited to be here. And I'm hoping you'll take most of this stuff home with you so you can try it out and maybe share it with your family.
Yay! For years, Mercy Hospital and its medical centers haven't had a strong presence in the St. Charles area, but that's about to change in a really big way.
We were founded by a woman named Catherine McCauley, who grew up in Dublin, Ireland nearly 200 years ago. And she actually was befriended by a wealthy family who, in the proceeds of that, Catherine used to serve poor young women in Ireland. She eventually formed the religious congregation called the Sisters of Mercy, which is now a worldwide ministry in education and healthcare. Mercy is a large healthcare provider, and not only in the St. Louis area, but in seven states actually. And we believe in listening to people in the community and getting their opinions on how we should deliver healthcare. And in fact, we, over the last several years, we've had a number of meetings with people in the community asking them about healthcare needs in the community. And a common theme from people in the Tri-County area of St. Charles, Lincoln, and Warren counties is they wanted more convenient access and more ready access to physicians and services that Mercy provides. Here in this region, in the greater St. Charles area, the Missouri River for many people is a barrier to driving to our main hospital campus on Ballast Road in Creve Coeur. In fact, people said, gee, if you're gonna have a large medical facility, put it off an interstate highway. That was a very specific comment that came out of many of our focus groups. Now, not all of our buildings are on interstate highways, but they're on major thoroughfares. We've used external planning resources to look at the demographics of the region. And so we've tried to personalize services in a manner that's sensitive to sort of the age cohorts and the mix of people who live in different geographic areas. For example, in St. Charles, we've opened a building on Zumbel Road in September. That's oriented to serve adults, and a little bit oriented to maybe older adults, you might say. In Wentzville, we've opened a new office that has two pediatricians, and the reason for that is there's a younger demographic, a younger population to the western part of this area. Having physician offices and then certain diagnostic services within the same building is important to people. Why? Because it's convenient. Not only convenient in terms of time savers, but also convenient to allow physicians to get answers quickly about particular diagnoses and that sort of thing. So some of the awareness that we learned in doing our research with consumers about building design was that a lot of people are nervous when they go to the doctor. And so to the extent that the building itself can be sort of soothing, if you will, or designed in a manner that's comforting, that takes away a little bit of the edge on people's anxiety about dealing sometimes with a pretty serious medical issue. An item like bringing a great deal of lighting into the waiting room, we found to be important to people. Makes it a more calming kind of and relaxed kind of environment. Some of our facilities are intended to be smaller in size, making it easy for people to park. to find their way to the front door, to find their physician office when they get into the building, and then to actually get into the exam room to see the doctor. All that's part of our definition of access. Mercy's made a very big commitment to including technology in our health care delivery in future years. We've invested heavily in a common electronic medical record, for example. And so patients who see a Mercy physician who might go to a Mercy hospital or one of our centers, the information from their visit is stored in a common electronic record that makes it easy for all of the providers to have access to what happened on that particular visit. We've added a new feature. It's a kiosk, much like people might encounter if they went to an airport. They can swipe their credit card to identify themselves. They can, in that way, sort of check in to let the staff know that they're here for their visit. They can also do other things online while they're here. They can pay a bill, for example, or make a future appointment. But as importantly, they can access My Mercy. My Mercy is the name we've given to our patients portal, where the patients, either at the kiosk here or from any computer terminal at home or anywhere really, they can access some private information and have email communication with their physician offices if they wish.
With the holidays coming, we want to continue to remind people to shop here in St. Charles County. With the bridge being closed now, you know, it's more important ever that we support our local businesses. There are numerous ways to get into St. Charles. You can get in through Highway 364, Page Avenue, or you could take the Highway 370 bridge across on the north end of town. The Shopping with the Saints is a good opportunity for the two communities to come together. They both offer unique shopping. St. Peter's, you have the shopping mall. St. Charles, you have a great historic district. So they're really two different types of shopping. We also want to encourage people to get involved in a local charity during the holidays. There's Operation Food Search, there's St. Joachim Nan that does Adopt a Family. They're always looking for volunteers. People can get information about local volunteer opportunities through either the Community Council of St. Charles County or the United Way's hotline. New Year's is coming up. We want to encourage a lot of people to take a look at the Chamber list, whether they're meeting their resolutions or looking for a place to celebrate. St. Charles and St. Peter's offer a number of opportunities to go out and stay here in St. Charles County. If you're going to go out and celebrate, we encourage you to be responsible. You know, if you're supporting one of our local businesses and you live far away, we want to encourage you to stay at one of our local hotels. But there are numerous celebrations throughout both communities. Also, if you're looking at doing your New Year's resolutions, the Chamber has a number of businesses that, whether it's a fitness center or a nutrition shop, we have a number of businesses that you could use to take advantage of starting your New Year's resolutions.
Welcome to Quick, Fresh, and Delicious. I'm Robert. We're here today at De Olivas Oil and Vinegar on historic Main Street in downtown St. Charles. Today we're going to prepare for you a dish using freshly chopped dried figs. It's just sweet enough that you could serve it as a dessert. You could also serve it up as an appetizer. We're going to start our dish with a package of cream cheese. Now you can use regular cream cheese. I love regular cream cheese, but a lot of times I'm looking for a lower fat alternative. What I found is that the fat-free cream cheeses are not always that great tasting. So this 1/3 less fat has been a really nice compromise for us. The next thing that we're going to add is about a half a cup of chopped dried figs. Now my personal favorite are Turkish figs, and we're gonna cut up about five of these. Five of these finely chopped will make about 1/2 cup. For people who aren't big fans of figs because of all the seeds, dates make a wonderful alternative. It's a similar consistency and a similar sweetness that just happens to work out okay. We're gonna take our chopped figs and we're gonna add that to our cream cheese. And then to that, we're gonna add about 1/4 cup of slivered almonds. And we're gonna fold all this together. Now that we're done folding all the ingredients together, we're going to use these mini phyllo shells. They're pre-made. They're very handy. And all we do to fill these up is we put a small amount of the filling in the shell and set it down. Now this dish was originally inspired by the idea of crab rangoon. And I thought to myself, how cool would it be to do something like a fig rangoon. But one of the things, like I told you earlier, sometimes I'm looking to reduce the fats and I'm looking for ways to not fry things. And now we're gonna top these with a little bit of our fig almond spread from the Gracious Gourmet. And just about a quarter teaspoon on each one is just about perfect. There you have it. Fig almond tarts, quick, fresh, and delicious. Bon appetit.
UMB Bank was founded in 1913 and is based right here in the Midwest. Recently, my co-host Judy Peters sat down with Michelle Nischbach to discuss some of the ways that UMB is working with people to help them through these tricky financial times.
Well, Shelley, what do you attribute the tremendous growth and success of UMB Bank to?
Well, you know, I would attribute that really to the philosophy by which we operate, and that's by putting the customer at the center of everything. We're all about building relationships and creating a comfortable environment for our customers to really embrace the opportunity to leverage bankers to their benefit. You know, the last few years, the economic conditions have made it really apparent that we need to be really laser focused on delivering an experience that people can be really confident about. So our environment is all about being educational and being comforting so that our people, our bankers, are working with and really identifying and understanding our clients' individualized needs and wants so that we can help them get not only focused on meeting their goals but exceeding their goals and being excited about the opportunity to do that.
Well, UMB Bank has something called an advisor center. What is that?
Well, the advisor center, people are knowledgeable, exposed to traditional banking centers. And our advisor center is really focused on delivering a more personalized setting where our clients can come in and sit down with a UMB advisor or money coach and really focus on not just balancing their checkbook, but balancing their lives. So how do we go about really looking at building basic skills, you know, setting goals, budgeting, how do you save more, how do you spend less in order to embrace the financial future? And you know, creating an environment where our clients believe that they've got a partner that's really focused on helping them create success.
Can you tell us how the Advisor Center has actually helped someone?
You know, a recent example, we had a client or have a client that we really had not yet developed that personalized connection with. And this client, unfortunately, was dealing with a tough situation. She had just lost her spouse. And her spouse was the one that had, throughout the course of their marriage, taken care of all of their finances, right? Made all the complex decisions, did all the day in and day out stuff. And so she was really faced with some dilemmas on how do I embrace all of that, right? She had fears about how do I make sure that my money, you know, lasts as long as I do, all the way down to kind of the basic day in and day out, how do I adjust to my new world? And so the advisor or the money coach was really able to sit down and focus on her, and focus on what was important to her and create a foundation of confidence by teaching basic banking, day in and day out financial decision making, and you know, doing so as a partner. So she had that basis of confidence that she could start planning the future around where she really didn't have that base before. So the peace of mind and the comfort of having that partner really made a difference, I think, for her.
Well, what sets UMB Bank apart from other banks? You know, why should people choose UMB Bank?
Our focus is being unparalleled. And so we're all consumers. And so out there in everyday world, we, you know, can have opinions on how good service is or isn't. And in UMB, we really believe that we have a responsibility to create an experience and provide an outlet to our clients where they can really focus on what's important, what are their needs, their wants, their goals today, and having a partner that can give them direction, help them find, you know, like our client that I gave the example on, it can be real basic stuff, setting goals, creating budgets, saving more, spending less, all the way through more complex financial decision making. But they've got a partner that's really focused on and dedicated to the success that they're trying to achieve.
So if you wanted people to know one thing about UMB Bank, what would that be?
You know, I would come back to the word unparalleled. We have a phenomenal group of passionate associates that really take the sense of responsibility about creating an environment that allows our clients to really get focused and be excited about creating a strong financial future.
Streetscape's brought to you by Streetscape Magazine, a publication that features people, businesses, and events from all over the St. Charles area. You can pick up your free copy from a restaurant or business near you while you're out doing your holiday shopping. On past episodes, we've featured several restaurants owned by serial entrepreneurs Amy Grimes and Gurpreet Pada. This month, we're headed over to one of their more unusual venues located in the Grove area of St. Louis.
Sanctuaria is a restaurant that came about when Amy and I were traveling through Peru. We had gone to Machu Picchu and we had been caught in an incredible downpour. After the storm, we happened to be in a monastery and it was the exact polar opposite of where we had just been. Now we were sitting in this amazing sanctuary run by Catholic nuns. We were eating an amazingly warm, delicious meal. And that's essentially how the concept of Sanctuary came about. It was facing all of the hardship that you have and then comforting yourself in an amazing environment with amazing food.
It is a sanctuary within the city, I think. We're in a great neighborhood here and it's very eclectic. I think it's very much a sanctuary.
A lot of the artwork is a play on indigenous culture in the Americas. So you see a lot of Dias de Muertes scenes here, and you see a lot of angels and a lot of devils. And it's really a celebration of those two cultures. For us, it was very important to be able to bring that cultural concept together and provide it in the sanctuary. We're an evolving restaurant. We're not a restaurant that you created and it's all the same, and here it is, and this is what it's gonna be. This restaurant literally changes incrementally every single day. Every single day, my people, our people, learn something. And they take that information, they absorb it, they ingest it, and with that, they create new stuff. And our customers are a fundamental part of this. This menu and these concepts change constantly based upon the feedback that we get. This concept, the Sanctuary concept, has really grown on its own. We were probably the nidus. We were the element that brought it together. But really, we've let it grow naturally. And we've let it really become its own entity. Most people think that when we are talking about Latin American food, the first thing that they always jump to is, oh, it's Mexican. This has nothing to do with Mexican food. Latin America is a huge place. It includes Brazilian food, food from Cuba, food from Guatemala and Honduras and Nicaragua. Our goal is to provide St. Louis with food that is unique and special and flavorful, and it doesn't necessarily have to be hot. For example, our Wicked Good Shrimp. It's really a Creole combination with a combination from Cuba. It's not very spicy, but it's incredibly flavorful. I think that the concept of shared food is so primal. It goes really back to the caveman days, sitting in front of a fire. And it's that concept of sharing and discussing what happened that day and bringing it all together. You know, we're different. We're not a regular bar. You come to our restaurant, you come to our bar, and you're not gonna identify most of what we have behind that bar. We've really approached this differently. I have a heavy science background, and when we looked at this, we brought in people who were expert mixologists. And these mixologists are not just people that are bartenders. These people know how to engineer, and they know how to design, and they know how to titillate your tongue. They know what flavor profiles work with what.
And I think it's not that much different than food. It's not any different than, you know, what they're doing in the kitchen. The food is fabulous, the drinks are fabulous. They know how to pair them together, but also it's, you know, the cocktails are, they're the same. They're recipes, the things have to work together. And if you've never been here, you'll come here and realize that it's gonna be hard to drink anywhere else because the drinks are different. They work together in a way that it isn't typical.
StreetScape magazine and The Perfect Wedding Guide present Engaged. This bridal event includes a fashion show featuring the latest styles for every bride. From invitations to honeymoons, you'll find it here. The first 100 brides through the door receive a free bridal gift bag, and there'll also be thousands of dollars in prizes and giveaways, including a dream honeymoon. Last month, I spoke with Todd Gentry, a financial planner with MetLife, who gave us some great advice on retirement planning. Well, Todd's back with us to talk about financial health. So grab a pen, take some notes, because I guarantee you what he has to say is going to help you sleep better.
Financial wellness refers to how you feel about your situation today and how secure you feel about the future. It's not just about money. It's really about making appropriate decisions that can impact your health and the quality of your life. When someone is beginning the path to financial wellness, the best place to begin is education. The next step may be to consider hiring a financial advisor. Through my work at MetLife, we provide education programs through employers that give access to employees. In order to become financially healthy, you need to take responsibility. And remember that this is about you. You need to understand where you're at, implement steps that are specific to you so that you can overcome procrastination, which is probably the biggest challenge. Changing financial behaviors leads to a sense of control. To gain that sense of control, many people might want some financial advice or an advisor, some guidance. In many cases, employers are offering that sort of guidance to their employees at the workplace. Financial education is wanted by employees of every age and every income. Employers should be looking for credible sources for that information. And MetLife is a leading financial educator and can provide solutions for employers of any size.
And so we've reached the end of another show. We want to thank the Peabody Opera House for hosting us. For more information about upcoming concerts and events like Flashdance the Musical, visit peabodyoperahouse.com. We're glad you could join us for this holiday episode of Streetscape. And no matter how you celebrate, Christmas, Hanukkah, Kwanzaa, or other traditions, we wish you a safe and joyous holiday season. I'm April Trupiano, and you can find me at apriltrupiano.com.
Streetscape is part of Two Guys Talking Podcast Network and brought to you by Streetscape Magazine.